I have one other thing, and it is with great sadness, a dear friend of all of us has passed. Al Thomas, one of Milton's finest citizens, passed away earlier today. There aren't enough words to describe Al Thomas. He was a family man, a man of faith, a businessman, a philanthropist, sportsman, and above all else, a gentleman. Al was devoted to the town of Milton, was a heart and soul of Milton Kiwanis, and dedicated to all veterans. He generously touched countless Milton residents, and we are the beneficiaries of his endless gesture of kindness. So please join us in a moment of silence to remember Al Thomas. Thank you. So first order of business is the approval of the minutes of June 16, 2015.
So moved.
Okay. Second that.
Motion made and second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Item three on the agenda is confirmation of future meeting dates. Right now we have August 18th, September 1st, and September 15th.
Good with May.
Okay. I'm just going to check on September 15th because I'm going to be up in northern Maine. I think the 15th is okay. I'm pretty sure it is. I think it's a week after that I'm up there, but I'll let you know.
Those dates are good for me. Are we going to stick with the two meetings a month, which
I have no problem. Yeah, once we get into budget season, I know it gets more difficult. I have no problem. We could try and throw in one more meeting, maybe the end of September.
Because we did talk about at the end of last, maybe around May or June, talking about in the summer going to the two meetings, but in the fall, because of the length of our meetings, maybe going to three meetings
right.
a month.
So I have no problem with that. I couldn't do it the week after September 15th. I'm definitely out of town. The last week in September, I could probably do it. And the second week in September, that's Labor Day, isn't it? Yeah.
And I will just call your attention, Mr. Chairman, that I will be out of town on September 1st, but your assistant town administrator will be filling in for that meeting.
Very good. Okay, so we're going to put one more in for September 30th?
Yes.
That week?
Yep.
That last week of September?
Yes.
Okay, item four is the approval of payroll and vendor warrants.
Okay, I'll move that we approve the current payroll and vendor warrants.
Second.
Okay, motion made, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all is in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And if you don't mind, I'm going to hold off on citizen speak, because I know there are a lot of people here that do want to speak, and we do have to get Joe out of here. So I'm going to skip to item number seven, which is a conference of the DPW water and sewer rate change. Hi, Joe.
Good evening. On behalf of the DPW study committee downstairs, I thank you. They need to help with that meeting down there shortly. So I forwarded the report off to you folks about a week and a half ago. And just in a brief summary, it's the same methodology that we've been using for years with regards to looking at a rate analysis, which is simply to take our total projected costs of direct operational costs and indirect costs and together support them by the various means of revenue that we generate in the water department, which is typically driven by special bills for inspections and testing and whatnot, but mostly driven by ratepayers. And the report analyzes a forecast of water consumption based on a prior three-year history, and then looks at what we've done and bases some conservative estimates on what we might look at. This year, as in the past couple of years, we've looked at a projection of a 2% reduction in sales over or below last year's sales level. But last year's sales level were actually about 10% higher than the year before. So in reality, we're projecting a 10% increase, if you will. But nonetheless, we want to be conservative in maintaining something a little less than the prior year, because if all it takes is one particularly wet summer and irrigation sales drop off, and that's at our highest tier. Typically, they're at the tier four, and that can have a dramatic effect. So that 2% cushion per year seems to be working out pretty well. One thing that this report does that no prior year has done is speak to the success, what we think to be the success of the consideration that you folks made last year with the multi-unit tenants, you know, multi-unit build, residential buildings. If you remember, there was an adjustment made last year on all multi-resident units above 10 or more. And by doing that, we were somewhat concerned, you know, what would happen to the revenues. We did a pretty good analysis, and it showed the this year's analysis showed that we in fact hit our revenues despite that. So it seems to be working well. You know, those folks who felt that they were being penalized by living in a condo situation as opposed to a single family resident situation, you know, seem satisfied. In fact, for the past year, not a single complaint. So it seems to be working well. So the front end of this report speaks to the success of that. We used the same methodology. We assumed that it was so successful we weren't about to change anything again this year. We'd leave it intact. So this year's assuming the same principle that we continue to give the break to the multi-unit residences.
I have a question related to that. How is it working administratively for your staff in terms of doing the manual adjustments?
So if you remember, there was pretty great concern if we did it for all multi-units, so we picked the 10 residential units and above.
Yep.
Deliberately for that. It's, you know, it's a little bit of a calculation every quarter, but it's not unwieldy. Good. So it is working out pretty well.
Good, thank you.
So as we've done in the past, and for the first time officially, we are enterprise, but we address the rates separately for water and separately for sewer, because they are two separate business entities, if you will. We have our costs, which what are voted at town meeting. So that, you know, that's a pre-established amount. Clearly, if you remember, when in years past, when the warrant goes to press, all we have is the preliminary assessments from the MWRA. And inevitably, by the time town meeting closes and we get to this point here, at the end of the fiscal year, the MWRA comes up with final assessments, which they have again this year. The preliminary sewer assessment and final sewer assessment are, I believe, are identical. And there is a slight decrease from what the final water looks like compared to what the preliminary. So the... But an increase
from
anyway.
The year before.
From the year before. I'm sorry, yeah, make that clear. Decrease from the preliminary assessment, which in itself was an increase. So that means that our forecast of direct costs are pretty accurate. You know, there was no, you know, large fluctuation in the final assessment.
So in terms of MWRA, how did our water usage compare relative to other communities? I mean, I know we had a spiking in one year, but last year we actually were down, I think, relative to philosophy.
Yes, so you say as compared to other communities, that's an important distinction, because it doesn't really much matter how much you use up or down compared to prior years. It's how much you use
relative
as compared to others, and it's called flow share, because their assessment is based on flow share, you know, how it's divvied up across the utility. Our flow share was up a little bit over last year. I don't have the final numbers with me tonight, but we get monthly reports and then quarterly reports on flow share, and we were up total consumption about 10% over the prior year in sale of water, and our flow share was up about 2% as compared to other, you know, other communities.
Okay.
So we were right in the middle of the group. We still continue to be tracking lower on the sewer. Our flow short share of what we contribute into the sewer system continues to decrease each year. And it's because we've been very aggressive with removal of inflow and infiltration.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting that extraneous flow out of the system, tightening up the system, and, you know, finding people that are, you know, have some pumps connected to the sewer system, you know, and asking to disconnect them. We find it's a measurable benefit. So we're seeing our share go down, you know, by that way. And honestly, it's the success of the MWRA II program. We use every penny that we get, and it's not only do we get their money at low interest and a grant, but we also get dividends by lower assessments in the future. So it's a pretty good program. So we're going to vote separately and discuss separately the water and the sewer. I talked about the costs. The costs come right out of each of the articles, 19 and 20, in this year's meeting. the revenue end of it comes out of what you need to raise from those costs, and then the analysis breaks down. Quite frankly, looking at all of the bills we issued for the course year, how many at Tier 1, how many at Tier 2, Tier 3, and make a forecast from there moving forward. And that establishes what we would need to raise at each of those tiers in order to meet that revenue obligation. So with all of that methodology in place, what it really boils down to is that we would need a 4.4% increase in our water rate over last year's. I can give you the numbers of what that means, but we can probably wait till a later part. And then on the sewer, we need a 2% increase on sewer. Now, keep in mind, the largest part of your bill you receive at home is sewer. So what that nets out to be on the average person's bill that they receive is a 3% increase total, you know, on average. You know, the lower tiers, it's a little bit higher, 3.1%. On the remaining three tiers, it's 2.9%. But ostensibly, it's a 3% increase net. So what does that mean to folks at home? If you remember, we have various cases that we look at. So, and we can make this, once the board has seen this, we can put this on the town's website tomorrow morning. Each of the cases talks about, you know, the type of household you might have and the number of cubic feet you might use in a typical quarter for the various cases, 8 standard cases, and then the average MWRA nuclear family. And what it really boils down to on that average MWRA nuclear family, which is a family of 4, that uses 3,000 cubic feet of water per year, you're going to see a total quarterly household increase of $14. So it's like $56 a year increase over the bill that you've been paying this past year. That's what you would likely see. That's a Tier 2 customer, by the way. The highest tier person who uses the most amount of water, typically the heavy irrigators, or restaurants and whatnot, will see about a $46 per quarter increase, or about something shy of $200 per year increase over the water bill they're paying this year. So I gave a very quick summary. I hope you all had a chance to review the report that I had sent off. And if you have, you certainly can ask some very detailed questions I'll try to answer. If not, I can get you better answers, tomorrow if need be.
I do have, if you could just explain, Joe, in the past couple of years, we've used fund balances to help mitigate rate increases. I noticed this year we did not. I don't want to couple that with a discussion of the new project that we have going for the tank replacement and the increased debt there and what that might mean to water rates in the future.
Sure. So like any business, you can either oversell or undersell your product, and based on your sales, it's going to determine whether you make money or lose money. And in a perfect world, you make exactly what you said you set out to make. Okay. So in reality, sometimes you run a deficit and sometimes you run a surplus. In enterprise accounts, that's called fund balance when you run a surplus. So when you do have a robust year of sales, you do have surplus monies. Sometimes the strategy might be to use some of those funds to ameliorate rate increases, particularly if we see a dramatic change in assessments from the MWRA, or looking at the big picture, what sort of financing impacts might you have. Now, you folks are very much aware, and people at home may be aware, that we have 3 major water projects going on with a $6.7 million price tag, $5.4 million of which is bonded. That bonding will hit the market next year. Maybe a portion of that cost will be borne in an FY17 rate, but not in the 16 rate at all.
Right.
I think the lion's share of that impact will be felt for the first time in FY18. So the strategy would have been to hold what fund balance we had this year, and since the assessments from the MWRA were pretty nominal, to hold off fund balance to hit those out years when the financing hits as a way to throttle and control stabilize the rates at that time.
Okay.
Joe, you mentioned that you're going to have something online tomorrow, and I appreciate the detailed report that you put together. It's very well done. related to the rate impact analysis. Is that what you're going to have up there on site?
I would put this entire report out on site, and I will prepare an executive summary that try to.
Good.
This is somewhat technical.
To simplify.
Somewhat technical. I would try to call out.
Just because I just want to be wary of some of the residents when they hear an increase, that they are afforded the opportunity to talk about that increase with someone from your department. You know, when the questions do arise, I don't mm-hmm. want it to kind of tag on. You know, because I think it's important that when residents do call, that we do respond to them. And I think this is an excellent report. And just to make sure that they do understand the increases.
This is written in such a fashion that it's somewhat technical. I think the average person
right.
at home might understand it, but someone who's really not diving into the nuts and bolts of
right.
the numbers,
it is technical.
It needs a summary. It needs
right.
a summary to
great.
Preface
no, I appreciate it. That. That's excellent.
Joe, very briefly, it's a little bit off topic, but somewhat related. How are we doing in the unbilled sewer collections?
So we made some great inroads, obviously very early in the process, and we continue to pick off that lower hanging fruit. We were moving quite well until winter hit pretty hard. We continue to pick through it this spring, but with the we have a situation in the department with manpower resulting in an extended absence, and with the water projects going on, we're right out straight. So we've done nothing this summer. We intend to hit the ground again pretty solid, you know, mid-fall.
Well.
And going back in. What we're continuing to do, though, is on every single real estate closing, if we do a final reading, we do a final inspection. We pick up a lot of situations in that. We're looking for sewer connections, particularly on those who say they don't, have them getting bills. We're also looking for other things like inflow, some pumps and whatnot.
Okay.
So, we continue to do those on a regular basis with every single final reading. And we do catch some of those, even in the summer month, we've been getting those.
John, just real quick, and if you give just like a 30-second, because there have been some questions about, why are we spending all this money to replace water tanks and that whole project there in terms of the pressurization of the system. Could you just explain that?
30 seconds.
Well, as quickly as you can.
All right, simply,
I know you want to get downstairs.
Yeah, thank you, yes. Simply put is, pressure has to operate at an elevation. The tanks are at an elevation. And to balance between those tanks, two on Chicken, one on Big Blue, requires a network of piping between all of those. It also requires a pressure feed from the MWRA connection. So what we have is a loop of piping that's in Canton that has been acting as an equalizer between the tanks, and we have a pressure system at the MWRA interface that's higher than it ought to be. And lastly, the other pipes within our own town connecting the tanks together are old and tuberculated, meaning narrowed and down, so they're not as efficient as possible. So there's three projects that came out of that, rehabilitating the tanks, which are 80 years plus. That's based on a cost analysis, benefit cost analysis, rehab versus replacement, and clearly replacement was cost effective.
Those tanks are how far beyond the useful life, estimated useful life?
40 years beyond the useful life, and 20 years beyond the major rehab. And when you looked at that on a recurring basis with an 80-year-old tank, it just made sense to replace them outright. The piping network in town is about $2.5 million worth of work. That's replacing what we're going to call transmission mains between the two tanks within our area and to improve fire flows within those areas.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly is the pressure-reducing vault up on Metropolitan Avenue, which is going to act as a throttle at that pressure zone with the MWRA to allow our tanks to drain during the day during high demand and then refill at night to keep that fresh water. Remember that situation we talked about with
yep.
to keep the water in the tanks fresh, because anything more than a day and a half, a couple of days, chlorine drops off, water quality drops off, and public health threats become a question.
So now, as opposed to having to dump water out of those tanks, you can actually let the pressure down.
In the ultimate is way to keep those water fresh. Now we are dumping the tanks periodically to the tune of a million gallons every couple months of wasted water that we've paid for that doesn't hit any of our own meters.
Mm-hmm.
This prevents that. This will prevent that forevermore.
So essentially the ratepayers are paying for that dumped water.
That's right. It's right. So in reality, we might see our ultimate consumptions drop somewhat.
Great.
Great question. Sorry it took more than 30 seconds.
Well done.
Any other questions?
No.
Do we have a motion here?
I'll move that we approve the recommendation of the Director of the Department of Public Works to increase the FY16 water rates by 4.4% over those rates that have been in place during FY15. This increase is to be applied across all four rate tiers to be effective for the bills produced beginning on August 10th, 2015.
I second that.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all is in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
Thank you.
And I'll move that we approve the recommendation of the Director of the Department of Public Works to increase the FY16 sewer rates by 2% over those rates that have been in place during FY15. This increase is to be applied across all four rate tiers to be effective for the bills produced beginning on August 10th, 2015.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all is in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe. Look at that. You have 5 minutes to spare.
Just enough time to set up PowerPoint. Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice.
Good night.
And I'm going to jump back to item five, which is... I'm going to jump back to item five, which is citizen speak. And I do ask if... because I know a lot of people here are here to talk about the Hillside development project. If there's some way, if rather than having everybody come up and say the same thing, if you know, if you are basically saying the same thing, if some people could just kind of coordinate together, and but if you all have something to add, we'll certainly hear. I just don't want to get into a repetitive kind of situation, that's all. So if anybody would like to address the board?
Just a quick question. Would you prefer that the people address their comments at the time the item is on the agenda? Or do you want to?
No, I'd rather not have it a back and forth. I'd rather have, if people have anything, citizen speak would be the proper time. Yes, come on up.
Make sure they say their name in the right place.
And could you please just state your name and address?
Hi, I'm Judy George. I live at 52 Ford Ranch Road in Milton.
Judy?
I've been asked,
Judy,
hi everybody. I've been asked to read this so I don't add any more flavor to it by John Lawton, who's the president of the Scottswoods and one of the directors, as is Webb and myself. And so we've talked a lot once we heard that. So if you don't mind. So, good evening. My name is Judy George. I live at 52 Ford Ranch Road and have been an abutter to the Fandry property for 50 years. Actually knew Mr. Hamilton when he was a kid. I'm also on the board of the directors of the Scottswoods Protection Fund. This is a group of 40 abutters and neighbors who have contributed to a fund to protect any dense development from happening on the Fandry property. I just got a letter today, so that's why I'm much more upbeat. I'm happy to hear that Mr. Hamilton is before the Board of Selectmen tonight to discuss his development. The Scottswoods Protection Fund was created to ensure that no dense development was approved on the 50-acre parcel that Mr. Hamilton proposes to build his development. On behalf of the abutters and the Scottswoods Protection Fund, I would like the Board of Selectmen to understand the following. The abutters are in favor of supporting an up to 12 single-family home cluster development with access to Ford Ranch Road, which, by the way, is exactly right beside me. So I've never been against Ford Ranch Road being, oh, I'm not supposed to add any flavor. John's going to be watching. He's testing me. Mr. Hamilton and the town of Milton have understood for almost 2 years that single-family home development has always passionately been supported by the neighbors and the neighborhood. We are committed to supporting a development, providing that the plan is fully understood and design plans inclusive of reasonable setbacks, elevation, roadway design, stormwater containment design, and wetlands encroachment are fully understood. And I think if we all started on the wrong foot in all of this, in the very beginning, if we had been more persuasive, we should, as a neighbor, persuaded Mr. Hamilton to meet with us. That's my added flavor. And I think we would have been much further along. The abutters are also in favor of supporting the plan and not opposing the plan, inclusive of agreeing to not appeal the plan, providing Mr. Hamilton communicates and discusses the key aspects outlined above to the abutters, which we think is fair. It is also important to note that under no circumstances will the abutters of Scotts Woods Protection Fund support any plan that contains the prospect of a 40B development. That means we're not going to sign a document that said, oh, by the way, if it doesn't, you know, support building single-family homes, you're on board for a 40B, friendly 40B. I don't know, what's a friendly 40B? I haven't heard about this friendly 40B stuff, but whatever. The Scotts Woods Protection Fund also strongly opposes any idea or thought of the Board of Selectmen of signing a local initiative project letter, LIP, for any project associated with the Fangery property off Hillside Street. So I'd like more than anything to work. I know Paul's been working very closely with Mr. Hamilton, but I would like to make this happen. It means probably more to me, having lived here my whole life in Milton and being right beside my house, that the idea of dense population would destroy, would crush everybody in that neighborhood. So we want to make this happen. And of course, a developer has to make money, and we want him to make money at the same time. And we think the new proposal that has been put forth, that just I just got today, the kindness of Mr. Hurley. I had never seen this letter till an hour before I arrived here, and he was, I was grateful that you sent that to me because it turned the whole meeting around for us. Thank you, and thank you very much for listening to me. I hope I was fast.
You're very fast. Would anybody else like to address the board? That it? Okay. Seeing none, we'll move on. So with that said, we'll move on to item six, which is a presentation of the Hillside Street local initiative program by Todd Hamilton. And just, Judy, a local initiative program is a friendly 40B. That's basically what it is. So Todd, if you'd like to... And obviously just state your name for the record. And
Todd Hamilton.
Paul Krasinski. And I live at 5 Stonehill Lane and a member of the Hillside Neighborhood Association.
Okay. Marion?
Mary McKetrick. I'm an attorney. I've represented Mr. Hamilton with some prior development proposals and have been working with him on his
way. Okay. The floor is yours.
All right. I guess I'll start and then I'll give it to Paul and Marion. We started with this in 2011 with three houses on 15 acres. Before we presented the plan, Marion went to each abutter and said, I'd like to explain to you what we want to do. Only one abutter would meet with her. And then I was asked to go to a meeting with her. We went back to the McDonough's house and we met and we talked about it. We filed the plan with the planning board for three lots. Open space development. We met all the requirements under the bylaw. Everyone, town council even backed us up on this. And some of the abutters said no to it. It's not happening. And Mr. Whiteside said no to it. And that was the end of it. Since then, we filed for another lot, a Form A lot, in addition to the three lots, which we got approved by a planning board, which was appealed by Jim Corliss to Superior Court, which we won, then appealed to the three-panel judge, which we won, which the town spent about $35,000 of taxpayers' money on for senseless, but that's what we did. And after that, I had no choice but 40B. And I was getting ready to file the 40B, and Henry's went in, so it kicked me out for 12 months. And I had to wait 12 months because my project was denied for a cooling off period. So I waited 12 and 12, which is 24 months. And over the 24 months, Judy and Mr. Driscoll and a few other people, we met in this room, I think it was December of 2012, to try and work something out. And we went around and around on it. We never got anywhere with it. We did work at it. And that kind of fizzled out in 2013 or so. And then I got a call, that was in March of 2013, 2014, it was right around the corner. I got a call from John Lawton that he wanted to work with me on this 8-lot development. I said, it doesn't work. I said, I got almost 3.5 years of taxes, legal fees, engineering, and interest occurring. I says, the longer this goes, the worse it's getting. So that was the end of that conversation. In April or March, I think it was, Maggie Oldfield contacted me and asked me if I would meet with her and somebody from the neighborhood, which was Paul. And I said, sure. So from that point this year on, there's been a lot of progress. Paul and I, he took emotions out of it. I took emotions out of it, and we kept hammering through it to make it work. I can understand why the abutters get emotional. It abuts their house. I understand it. When I bought my house up on Howland Street, the land, there was 2 lots for sale, each a 4.5 acres side by side. I didn't need both lots, but I bought the other one because I knew if I didn't, I was going to have a house on top of me. And I pay the taxes to let it sit there every year that I hate paying, but it's either that or have a neighbor right next to me. So that's the choice I had, and I had to live with it. But Paul and I got very far on this thing. He called me up after the Hillside Association voted on it. I think it was 23-2 or 23-3, am I right?
Yeah, it was exactly 24-3 in favor of support of an up to 12.
I'm in full support of it. I'm in full support of bringing a bridge in from Ford Ranch Road, doing it the way everybody wants to do it. But if I don't have full support from the neighborhood and I file this plan and I come into this town and it gets approved and an abutter appeals it, I have another 12-month cooling period from the time it's denied. So I could waste another 2 years. I've already wasted 36 months. I can't go forward because this thing's been like this. Either I have to have some insurance that if I'm going to go forward and spend all the money engineering it, spend all the money perking it, and bring it through all the boards, that there's some security there for me on the 12 months. If I can't have it, I can't go forward on the 12 lots, because I'm only writing my own ticket to 24-month delay again. And unfortunately, after Paul and I got the agreement just about wrapped up, and after the vote, I get a letter from the attorney, from Mr. Corliss, that if you sell that lot or build or do anything, we will appeal and file a lawsuit again. So he's basically forced me into a corner to tell me he's going to litigate and keep it going. If that's the case, I need insurance. If that's not going to go, I need the selectmen to work with me on a LIP project that we can all work together on if he appeals it. I'm only asking the selectmen to back it if somebody appeals it or a board denies it. I'm not asking them to back it if it doesn't perk. It has nothing to do with the selectmen or the neighbors. That doesn't perk, it doesn't perk. But, or some type of thing that we can all assure that we can go forward. And that's, you know, where I'm at. And I'd like Paul to speak if I said something wrong or said something I didn't say.
It was all wrong.
Okay. No,
just kidding. Thank you for hearing us out tonight. I think, one, you'll hear a lot of agreement. It was great to hear Judy's commentary representing the abutters and other neighbors. You know, I think it's, we'll hear a lot of agreement tonight. Agreement that everyone seems to now want up to 12 lots, single family, cluster development. Obviously no one wants, and I think Todd would highlight that too, the 40B. It just doesn't seem like the right thing for the property, doesn't seem like the right thing for the neighborhood, and certainly as both being neighbors of this property, it seems like it wouldn't be right to do. I think we also agree that it's been a long process. So it's been a focused process where, you know, we ultimately got to an agreement, which I will read to you guys. I think you received both the letter from Scott Johnson as well as the letter of support for the up to 12, which I will read just for everyone to hear. I think the challenge has been that really looking at this appeal, tonight was really the first time that we heard that there is full support for up to 12 and that there won't be an appeal for that. I still think that, you know, we need to continue to push that forward. I think we all are at the finish line and need to kind of move forward. However, what ultimately, as of July 22nd, kind of broke down some of the negotiations was the fact that there wasn't an assurance that if we move through this process, what happens. So I had reached out to legal counsel to represent me personally in the Hillside Neighborhood Association to really understand what the cooling off period means. So I'll read kind of two things, but first I wanted to read, just for everyone's benefit, the letter that was sent to Hamilton Realty. So, dear Mr. Hamilton, we, the Hillside Neighborhood Association, are writing to inform you that we agree to support and not oppose a single-family detached home cluster development of up to 12 lots. There were two meetings of the HNA, Hillside Neighborhood Association, on April 21st and May 4th, 2015, to discuss this plan. During the second meeting, there was a formal vote conducted and tallied by HNA President Scott Johnson, and this vote resulted in a strong support for the up to 12 cluster home development, with the final vote tally being 24-3 in favor of up to 12 lots. The purpose of this letter is to show our agreement to facilitate approval of an up to 12 lot cluster home development on the site and parcels off Hillside Street and Ford Ranch Road. Given this strong support from the Hillside Neighborhood Association, Hamilton Realty will conduct the percolation test, or perk test, and formal wetland survey on the property to determine the carrying capacity of the land, of how many lots can be developed, but up to 12 lots. Hamilton Realty also will file the necessary applications for approval for the up to 12 lot plan with public boards and public officials. The development will require approvals by town officials and public boards and commissions, including but not limited to the Milton Board of Appeals, the Milton Planning Board, the Milton Conservation Commission, the Building Commissioner of the Town of Milton, and the Milton Town Engineer and Department of Public Works. Such applications will include but are not limited to an application for one or more variances from the Board of Appeals, the application for single-family cluster development from the Planning Board, and a notice of intent to the Milton Conservation Commission. If the project receives, and I think this is really important, if the project receives all the necessary town approvals but is subsequently appealed, notwithstanding those approvals, it is understood that Hamilton Realty will pursue a residential development under Local Initiative Chapter 40B project. The parties acknowledge that the public boards, commissions, and officials have duties and responsibilities determined by the laws and regulations of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the town bylaws, and town regulations. Therefore, it is not possible for this agreement to control the outcome of any hearing or applications to public entities such as those listed. The parties acknowledge that all physical characteristics of the property and whether those characteristics would allow the development to proceed are not yet completely known and will become, even though the percolation tests, a formal wetland survey, and any other testing required by Hamilton Realty. Don't worry, I'm almost done. The parties further agree that if development receives all necessary approvals, Hamilton Realty or its successors and assigns will build a bridge and roadway or driveway to provide access to the development and will bring utilities to the property. A specific plan for this development will be created in accordance with the approvals by town and public officials and public boards. We look forward to continuing to work closely with the town of Milton and Hamilton Realty to realize this up to 12 lot cluster development and resolve this issue that has consumed much time, energy, expense, and resource from all of the parties involved, including yourselves. Please sign below to acknowledge your agreement with this proposal, which will be submitted to the Board of Selectmen as well as public officials and public boards as required by the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Milton. Sincerely, Scott Johnson, President, Hillside Neighborhood Association. And so that letter was submitted to you guys, I believe, last night or earlier today. And I think really what it came down to was we were ready to sign and execute that. Scott had actually executed that. And I think the challenge was this legal letter that came, which was either threatening an appeal, threatening an action. And really that created the non-assurance. And so if we look at this from a perspective of kind of interfering with advantageous contract relations, if we look at this all the way around from the town, the neighborhood, the abutters, and even Todd, I think we have figured out a mutually beneficial resolution here and a solve, which, you know, I will commend Todd for being a collaborator and an innovator and getting right to the point. I don't think he ever, you know, fluffed up any of the direct comments that he had for me or others. But really, we don't want anyone at this point in the process abusing the rights that are granted, you know, through the court for their appeals process and incur more expenses, create longer pieces. So as I had mentioned, I reached out to Rob Tuckman, who was a retired partner at WilmerHale and who led their real estate and environmental practices and is known nationally. Really, that he highlighted to me that in this case, having it be an up to 12 lot plan, again, it has to perk, that's, you know, Todd's responsibility, that really the repetitive petition does not apply in this case because it was an up to 12 lot plan. And if it was denied or rejected or appealed, you know, Mr. Hamilton would have the ability to move forward with, you know, the alternative that he would want to look at. So I think that was still up in the air. I think our respective legal advisors were providing kind of two different spins on that. And really, I think for us, one, the neighborhood supports it. You know, certainly it sounds from Judy that the abutter supported, which is great, and I think they've been an incredible asset to the entire process. I think now we need your advice on how best to proceed in order to kind of push this over the finish line where we are so close and put this kind of three-year process to bed. So we look forward to your advisory and input, and obviously we're prepared to, you know, help and support in any way that we can.
Just one question. You mentioned that you had hired an attorney, and he said that the there would be no cooling off period with respect to a 40B. Is that what we're really talking about?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you don't think that's true, Todd?
Marion doesn't, and two other attorneys that I've talked to in the last 3 days.
Okay.
I've been to three attorneys. One's a 40B attorney for the town of Dedham. One's an attorney down in Easton that specializes in it, and they all disagree.
And again, it was the advisory, but I'll read from his excerpt here, and I can get more detail for us as well. But again, I hope that we can, you know, figure it out. So it says, I don't have copies of the general laws here, such as life as a retired attorney, so I can't look it up. But the anti-repetitive petition statute is either in the Zoning Act C-40A or in the Subdivision Control Law C-41, S-81, or both. The idea is that if you are turned down by the ZBA or the Planning Board, you shouldn't be able to refile and keep pestering them until they change their minds. There's an exception for changed circumstances, or some such phrase. So if you wanted to do a simple lot subdivision for single-family homes and then switch to a multifamily development, that's not a repetitive petition. His lawyer should be able to check the exact language of the statutes and give him advice and the necessary confidence. So that's, again, one opinion, and certainly we can make it more formal. Mm-hmm. But I thought it was an important issue here as we start to look at providing, you know, Mr. Hamilton with some assurance that if we proceed down this path, that there isn't, you know, that two-year or one-year waiting period.
Okay.
I don't want to dwell overly long on this issue because there's always the possibility that there's been a different interpretation or that there's a case that I'm not aware of. But I think we're talking about apples and oranges on that particular issue because I think what this attorney is talking about is the general zoning bylaw and subdivision approval, but particularly the zoning 40A law, which prohibits somebody from bringing the same application for zoning relief within 2 years.
Right.
It's a different. Mm-hmm. It's another prohibition that keeps you from keep continuing to refile the same thing.
Right. Right.
And so there's that's a restriction when a developer wants to keep filing applications. And then under the regulations that were enacted by Department of Housing and Community Development for 40B, which is an affordable housing law, there is a regulation that was tightened up and sort of rewritten in 2008 that specifically addresses the issue of what happens if a developer has a prior application before a town for some kind of development and then wants to file a 40B if the prior application is not completely over.
Right, you can't use a 40B as leverage, basically.
And is there a waiting period before a developer can file a 40B? And the reason this came about as an issue was because developers were trying to file applications simultaneously or immediately and basically use one as a leverage for the other.
Right.
That's not what's happening in this situation, and that's why I don't want to dwell overly long on this issue. But as far as I know, that regulation that pertains to a cooling off period does apply if Mr. Hamilton were to file a new application for relief from the Board of Appeals and for cluster zoning approval from the Planning Board, and that process were completed, and let's say he received approval from both boards so that he could go forward, and at that point the case were appealed, and let's say he goes through a whole appeal process and he loses. From the time that concludes, he has to wait 12 months. If he chooses to withdraw his application because an appeal is threatened, then the 12 months is, from whenever the thing becomes final, the 12 months starts to be counted. There is no exception that I'm aware of. The only exception is if your prior development proposal has at least 10% affordable housing in it, you don't have to wait 12 months, which also covers any prior 40B development. So you can file successive 40B developments, different types, and not have to wait. Mm-hmm. Or you could be like the Hendry's project and file an approval before a planning board for that type of development that had 10% affordable housing. And when that's denied and you decide not to appeal, you can go right ahead and file a 40B application because it was 10% affordable housing. So that's my understanding of the regulations. And the main point to remember here is that it's incredible that the neighborhood has come together behind a 12-lot proposal, which is more dense than what would be allowed under the zoning bylaw. And even equally incredible is that the developer, after all this time, and the owner, are willing to talk about that proposal and do all of the due diligence that they would have to determine whether it works, that they're working together on this proposal. And this fallback option of saying, it would be great to have that assurance that if this fails because there's an appeal, that I could go to the selectman and say, would you talk about a LIP instead of a conventional 40B? Well, we don't want that option. Developer doesn't want it, the neighborhood doesn't want it, but there's a big risk and a lot of expense associated with exploring another development proposal. Because, you know, it's incredible how much money gets spent. It's not legal fees primarily, although the legal fees are expensive, but it's engineering primarily, and time.
And taxes.
Taxes, and the fact that the owners have had this land available since 2005 and have been interested in selling it for development and haven't found a way to do that will bring them a reasonable return. That's a long time to wait. And so I think it's a problem that needs resolution. I think the selectmen can help with it if they need to think about it. I would want to emphasize that there isn't a lot of time because it takes several weeks to get ready to do this perk testing. Fall is almost upon us. So unfortunately, you know, time is really pressing. And that's why we're here before this. That's why Todd is here and Paul to talk to the selectmen. We know that you're not the planning board, but we also know that you would play a key role if there were ever to be an approach made for a LIP. Mm-hmm. And we want you to think about that, whether, you know, if that appeal should happen, are you willing to say, we would be willing to sit down and talk about a LIP. We can see why it would be necessary at that point.
Can I ask another question, Todd, or from whoever, I guess? On the 12-unit development we're talking about in a cluster zone, wouldn't be under the cluster zoning bylaw because it doesn't meet that
Correct.
Cluster zoning bylaw. So the cluster development that you're proposing would not include an affordable unit in it?
No.
Okay.
No.
And there's no way to do that. My understanding from listening to Marion is that if we're 10% affordable, which would be one unit in that case, then you could proceed with a 40B should it get appealed.
I mean, unfortunately, what you would end up having to do is add more units.
$1.5 million homes, that's a lot to give up.
Yeah.
So I have a question, Mary and Todd as well. Over the last couple of days, I received different versions from you, Marion, through Anne Marie, and then also from Scott Johnson, the president of the Hillsack. And they varied. There were big discrepancies on what Scott signed. One was an unsigned document from you, and one was signed today, that I received today, strongly opposing a LIP.
If I don't have some insurance, I can't move forward. I wasted 24 months already. I'm not wasting another 24 months.
No, I understand that, but I guess what my question circles back to is, why did I receive, and my fellow colleagues receive, something to make us believe that the neighborhood was agreeing to all those measures, when then today I received something that was different?
I didn't even know you were getting that today.
The one I sent you was referred to in Todd's memorandum. It was what was given to us. Todd received it from the Neighborhood Association.
Unsigned.
On the 25th of July.
It was an updated version.
I believe it was unsigned. Well, I don't think it was signed.
No, it was unsigned. It was
the initial draft that I sent, the one
additional line that was added, which ended up not or leading to the falling apart of the negotiation, yeah, was the extra line on the contingency, okay, that the neighborhood
supports
a LIP 40B project. And so we weren't going to sign that. You know, obviously, it's not, none of us, as we highlighted today, support a 40B. Certainly, we don't, as the Hillside, okay, Neighborhood
Association. Just for clarification, I just want to be clear, because the one I received today, signed from Scott Johnson, was strongly opposing that they were in favor of up to 12, but strongly opposing.
I had a similar question related to that, because we did receive the July. Well, it's not, the copy we have is not signed, but it's dated July 25th. But I thought that was what Paul just
read. That's what I read.
That's what you just read.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's a little confusing, because that letter says it's understood that Hamilton would pursue a LIP. But the letter we got today, from signed by Scott Johnson, said the neighborhood is opposed to a LIP. So,
well, it doesn't mean that the neighborhood supports it.
Okay, no, so it's just that it's just a recognition. I just want to be clear that
it sounded
a little different from what you were saying tonight.
Yeah, so what I read and what I asked. So the Scott Johnson, knowing that this meeting was happening with the Board of Selectmen, felt as though the neighborhood had to have its own voice to let you understand where our position was. That was the first document that you received, where he highlighted the opposition as far as the suitability for that property for a 40B. That was the first bit. The second attachment that he had is the 25th letter that I wrote, which also highlights the fact that we understand that there's only one other option here, and that we had been placed in this predicament, I will say, by the fact that there had been a legal action taken by Mr. Corliss against the town of Milton, and that legal action was threatened to continue should access be anything off of Ford Ranch Road. So that led to the question, the driveway. So I think that led to Scott Johnson highlighting, if this meeting is going to happen about our support for a LIP or any 40B project for that matter, that was not something we were going to sign. That was not something that we wanted. So you have the July 25th version, which highlights we understand what the alternatives are. It did not highlight support for that. And Scott's further clarification was his highlighting of, here was the agreement, here was the support of up to 12, and here was why he didn't feel, and representing the neighborhood, that it was suitable for characteristics of a 40B. So those are two documents that you guys received today.
All right, so I guess for clarity's sake, so you're saying that in this letter says it's understood that Hamilton would pursue a residential development under a LIP. And a LIP obviously means it's a friendly 40B, it's not a hostile 40B. So I guess the neighborhood is saying through this letter that they understand that Hamilton will pursue it. The only way he can pursue it is by an agreement with the town through the Board of Selectmen. Is
correct.
That correct?
Correct. And what we highlighted,
you'd be a co-applicant. That's what a LIP is.
And what our statement in that paragraph specifically means is that we understand that process. We understood, too, that as the neighbors, we could not grant that to Mr. Hamilton. It would have to come here. But it was not something that we were prepared to support It was just, we had knowledge that that was the alternative.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that, because
Yeah, no, thank you.
They did seem to be a little bit inconsistent, but that clarifies.
Yeah, the reason that letter was given to you was because it was sent to Mr. Hamilton as the proposal that had been agreed upon by the Neighborhood Association, and we were basically sort of stopped at that point. Mr. Hamilton had originally requested additional language in that letter with more, you know, more talk, more of a condition to his agreement that he get an assurance that the Selectmen would look at a LIP.
I mean, I can't go forward for another 24 months. I just wasted 36 months.
We couldn't get agreement on that. They couldn't in the actual letter of agreement. So, and we had planned to come to the Selectmen anyway. If we'd reached agreement on that letter, we would have been able to come to you and say, here, we have the letter, now we'd like to talk to you about this. And so what we're saying is, we have this form of agreement, I think that's what's been agreed to, is the letter that Paul read to you, and that we want you, the Selectmen, to think about whether you could give encouragement to the idea that if there's an appeal of this 12-lot proposal, which seems to be the final good alternative that's been put forward for this site, that you would say, we would talk to you about that, we will work with you on that. If we have no proposal for you, you know when you agree to a LIP, it's when you sign the application, which is the end of a process of developing a project. Just as Judy George was saying, we have a 12-lot concept here, but we don't have a plan yet, and she's, you know, she wants to see the details. So every plan is like that.
There is a plan that's been out there. I've given it to Paul.
Yes.
The whole neighborhood saw the 12 lots.
Yes.
It shows the road going out to Ford Ranch Road.
Yep.
I know Mr. Corliss doesn't want us using our own driveway, which is fine. We'll put the bridge in, and he can keep our driveway, but maybe he can pay the taxes on it. Because I'm not going to pay it if I can't use it. And I'm fine with that. But I cannot go forward anymore, because one day Paul calls me, we're all set to go. One day I get something in the lawyer's letter. Another day I get, we're not doing this. It keeps doing this. And if anybody was sitting in my shoes at this table spending what I'm spending, you'd be in the same position saying, hey, you know, I could spend until March getting this thing permitted. That's 8 to 9 months. It's all approved. And Mr. Coles decides he doesn't like it now, and he appeals it. So I wasted 8 months and all that money. And then I can start my cooling off period from then. I'm all done with it. This is it. If we're going to do it, I'm not asking this board to back it, only if it's appealed or denied. That's it. Other than that, I'm not asking for anything.
And I think certainly the neighborhood has spoken in a strong support, you know, given the vote, which you now have in the letter that I read to you, and apologies that there was confusion. I think, unfortunately, we really don't want this to impact, you know, the town, the neighborhood, the abutters, Todd, the state of Massachusetts, based on one family. As I sit here, I represent approximately 150 families that have voted, that have shown that support. And we don't want, you know, continued legal action that doesn't make much sense at this point, where it would be questionable whether or not there's even standing in the court, given the, you know, rejections of those two appeals. So I just hope, you know, I think what we're looking is imploring your advisory here on the best way to move forward, knowing that, you know, the neighborhood does not support, you know, 40B, but does support, you know, an up to 12 lot plan, which is really what I, you know, read and highlighted and articulated. But I think coming full circle is, you know, I think we have a lot of agreement tonight, which is positive, you know, for everyone wanting up to 12 lots and no one really wanting 40B. I think that was, you know, the conversation that
the
Todd
same,
and I came to.
Same agreement with him on that.
Mr. Chair, if I could, and I know we don't want to go back and forth, but I do think that we do have some residents here that would probably like to give a little bit of input, because I will say that I have spoken to many of the residents in the neighborhood, and
I would prefer not to, only because we did give them time.
Okay. Well, I want to say that, and I'm first of all, I want to commend the Hillside Neighborhood Association for doing a great job and working really hard for the best interests of the neighborhood. As you know, all of our neighborhoods are really kind of crown jewels, and you know, to see a 40B go up in an area where it really doesn't fit would be would be troubling, I think, to a lot of people, and especially to such a beautiful neighborhood and the longest-standing neighborhood association in Milton. You know, and I do know that you had a vote, and it's 27-3, but I've received far more phone calls than the three opposing. And, you know, I want to be on record saying that you know, so I don't know where that math does come from, you know, with all due respect, because, I mean, I could probably tell you that I'm opposed to the language supporting a lip as an assurance, okay? And I think that that's the difficult part. I think that, you know, and I can understand where you are.
I can't go forward.
I can understand that. But at the same point in time, it's difficult because things could not work out, and that could be a reality. And I think to run that risk would be very difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody understands that the neighborhood does not support a local mission project or a 40B. You know, and clearly, personally, I would hate to see a 40B go in that neighborhood. But if it's a 40B, there's not a lot of control that we as selectmen have over it.
Sure.
I mean,
great.
It would just happen.
And I don't want to file it.
But Todd has said it's not his preference, and his memo has made that clear also.
Like I said, put yourself in my shoes. Every day it's a different
deal. You're a businessman, I understand.
So, yep. Todd, do you own that parcel, or do you have a purchase and
sale? I have it under agreement.
It's under agreement?
Yep.
Would you be able to show us a purchase and sale agreement?
It's no one's business but mine. I wouldn't show it. Would you show me a contract with somebody? I wouldn't do it.
I can, you know, he does have a purchase and sale agreement. I'm his attorney, and I know that he does, and it really shouldn't, it's quite unusual to require that somebody disclose
sure.
the terms. However, the terms are flexible in terms of when Mr. Hamilton has to actually purchase, and they've been working for years now on trying to find a suitable development scenario so that they can go forward with the purchase.
He'll go all the way. If it's got to be 40B, he'll wait 4 years. He knows we've had many discussions. It's written that way. Once I spend X amount of dollars, I'm in for the long haul. You get into it so deep, you can't turn back, and that's what's starting to happen. And who's really put it here? Abutters. They forced this thing down the throat of all the neighbors, including me.
So you're saying right now you've expended enough that you can't walk away basically.
Who's going to give me hundreds of thousands of dollars?
Well, I think to one key element here is, so I agree with you, Dave, and I would go on record as well as saying, you know, we don't support, you know, a lip. I think that was highlighted here, and I'm sure you got those phone calls. It certainly was not something that we had in the document that we supported or pushed through. I think the other piece is that each of the abutters, specifically Mr. Corliss most recently, because I was engaged in communications with him directly, we went through all of the creative options. You know, if you want to buy that Form A lot, that A&R lot, please feel free to do so. All I got back was, what's the price? And then I got a phone call to him saying, I'm not going to support that. I'm going to continue to appeal. So again, I think where we then said, okay, great. Well, so you aren't going to buy the property. He's going to sell the property, put it up for sale, and ultimately got a legal letter. So at this point, I think you do have strong support. And again, I think you're right. There was not, it's very hard with 140 to 150 families to get them all in the same place to vote. I think by proxy, the HNA voted on the support of up to 12. I think now we've got to be very transparent and very clear about what the issue is. Is the issue now is, one, we got to get the perks done to figure out up to 12. What does that even mean? What can perk? And that's on Mr. Yep. Hamilton. Second is, you know, the assurance is stemming from one neighbor, Mr. Corliss, where he has continuously moved this process forward from illegal, but remains silent while that process continues forward. I think it's very clear that we understand where that pushback's coming from. Now that we have support from the Scottswoods Protection Fund, from the Hillside Neighborhood Association, from Mr. Hamilton and Marion McKetrick, it seems to me again as a strong sign of support where helping, you know, and I understand the sensitivities around it. Would I want something right behind my house? No, I probably wouldn't. But if I had the opportunity to purchase that land, would I try to do it? Probably to the best of my ability, I would, or I would try to work through the process. I just feel like that has not happened in this case. So again, a lot of agreement, neither one of us want 40B.
No.
We both want the up to 12, but I really, we've hit an impasse, and that's where, you know, really we're hoping for your advisory. Certainly as a layperson and not a lawyer, you know, I can read an email and play one possibly on TV, but I leave that to other family members to do.
I got a couple of questions. Todd, this topic is very foreign to me, the perk test.
Yep.
What happens if, explain what that means and what happens if it doesn't perk?
If we didn't get the perks, then I would have to decide what to do. It's either going to have to be a 40B or a smaller project.
Smaller than the 12 houses?
Yep. And that would be whether Mr. Fandry wants to go with that or not.
And perk is related to sewer and whether you can
yes.
do septic. Septic.
You got to perk each lot for each house, two perks per lot.
Okay. So
you put your own drainage system in or?
I wouldn't put a common system in because selling single family houses with a common system, banks don't like to finance them. On condo associations, you can do it a lot easier because there's one building that ties into one pipe. But when it comes to single family, you can't control the other guy's garbage disposal, and you know, it just goes on and on.
So are you going to do this test regardless of?
No. I'm not going to spend $15,000-$20,000 to go out there and perk holes without knowing what the outcome of this whole thing is going to be. At this point, I am stopped. I've got a couple week window. I've spoke to the engineer. I've spoke to the land surveyor. Spoke to the tree cutter. We're looking at 5 or 6 weeks to get everybody on in play to locate where the perks have to be. Because you have to have a lot line to make sure the perks are on a particular lot, so they're on record. And that window's closing quick. And Paul and I worked all through May and June, and we had this thing done, and then this thing exploded with the lawyers' letters. And originally, the original agreement was every abutter with 300 feet was going to sign an agreement acknowledging the first draft that Marion did. And with 300 feet, acknowledging that they're for the project, not appealing the project, and didn't go. And that's why I'm here.
So, okay, so I would think that for the immediate abutters anyway and the broader neighborhood, obviously the best, the better result is the 12 houses, the up to 12 houses rather than the 77 units.
We're all agreeing.
You're all in agreement on that.
Correct.
And I, we want to encourage an agreement for a long time. Members of this board
Absolutely.
Have been trying to
no
bring
question.
The,
oh, no,
the
I,
neighbors
I,
and the developer together to try to reach some kind of agreement. Will you plan, you have a design over here for your 77 units.
That's 73.
73.